135 in your hymnal 435. What a wonderful change in my life has been wrought since Jesus came into my heart. Let's all stand together as we sing 435. What a wonderful change in my life has been wrought. I have light in my soul, for with long I had sought, since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart, since Jesus came into my heart, floods of joy o'er my soul, like the sea billows roar. Since Jesus came into heart, I have ceased from my wandering and going astray, since Jesus came into my heart. And my sins, which were many, are all washed away, since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart, since Jesus came into together, I shall go there to dwell in that city I know, since Jesus came into my heart. And I'm happy, so happy, as onward I go, since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart, since Jesus came into billows roar, since Jesus came into my heart.
All right. That was a great day when Jesus came into your heart. Amen. And if he hasn't ever, you've never invited him in, the Bible says he's knocking at your door. And but the problem is the knob's on the inside. And you have to invite him in. And if you've never done that, we trust today will be the day you do that. And if you have accepted Christ, then there ought to be joy in your life and joy in your heart. Amen. Good singing this morning. Good to see you in church today. We're looking forward to Brother Sharpette is going to sing right after the opening prayer. And the choir, I think, is going to help him, and because we know he needs help. And I'm teasing, but looking forward to them being here. And great Sunday school lesson this morning by Brother Sharpetta from Nehemiah. And they're leaving for Puerto Rico February 27th. And we're so glad that they came back through and we get a chance to see them before they go. And you get a chance to spend a little time with them and their family. And I hope you'll take the opportunity to do that. We're going to, at the end of the service, have special prayer for them. Have them come up and kind of a prayer of dedication and helping to send them on their way to Puerto Rico. But it's going to be a great service. I'm glad you're here to be a part of it this morning. Let's open with prayer, shall we? Father, we thank you for this morning. Thank you, Lord, for another opportunity for us to gather together here. Thank you, Lord, for the wonderful change that takes place in our heart when Jesus comes into our heart. Lord, he makes a difference in our lives. And Lord, I'm praying that you'll be pleased with the service here this morning, that Christ will be exalted, that he'll be lifted up in our midst, and that as you lift up Christ, we'll all be drawn closer to him this morning. So have your way in the music, have your way in our fellowship and the giving of the tithe and the offering, and Lord, honor the preaching of your word today. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
The chimes of time ring out the news. Another day is through. Someone slipped and fell. Was that someone you? You may have longed for added strength, your courage to renew. be new. Do not be disheartened, for I bring hope to you. It is no secret what God can do, what He's done for others, He'll do for you. With arms wide open, He'll pardon you. It is no secret what God can do. There is no night, for He is the light, will never walk alone. Always feel at home, wherever we may roam. There is no power can conquer you, while God is on your side. Just take Him at His promise. Don't run away and hide. It is no secret what God can do, what He's done for others, He'll do for you. With arms wide open, He'll pardon you. It is no secret what God can do. It is no secret what God can do.
Amen. Very good. Well, let's go over to 463. When the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, on that first together. When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal bright and fair. When the citizens shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, bright and cloudless morning, when the dead in Christ shall rise, and the glory of His resurrection share, when His chosen ones shall gather to their home beyond the sky, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, talk of all His wondrous love and care. And when all of life is over and our work on earth is done, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, when the roll
let's listen carefully now. A few announcements for us and regular schedule. As far as this evening goes, 5:30 for the Christian growth class. We meet in the conference room right across from the nursery, and tonight's lesson will be on prayer, helping you to understand prayers. There's a difference between saying prayers and praying, and learn what praying is in the Bible. And so we'll do that at 5:30 tonight. Then 6:30 for the evening service right back here in the auditorium. And Lord willing, tonight at 6:30 we'll talk about they that wait upon the Lord, a great verse from Isaiah. And we'll focus our thoughts on that this evening. And then there'll be something else tonight you don't want to miss. So don't miss the evening service. You'll be sad if you do. All right. And then remember, right at the conclusion of the service today, we want to have a special prayer of dedication for the Charpettas. Who has children's church today? Who has children? You don't, Mary Lou. Who has children's church? Brother Manuel. Okay. Just because he knows we're gonna come get the children with. You know, because I want the Charpetta children to be able to go if they want, but we want to bring them back in, all right, for that special prayer at the end of the service. All the kids, we want all the kids to be in for that, all right? And don't forget, men's breakfast this coming Saturday, and we'll have a great time together, fellas. 8:15, sign-up sheet is down on the table. Make sure you get signed up and be with us for the men's breakfast next Saturday morning. A week from tomorrow night, the 23rd of January, is your first ladies' night out for 2017. That'll be over in the fellowship hall. I think you have some sub sandwiches and such going on, and Ann Moreland's gonna do the preaching. Speaking. Sorry. You're gonna get to hear from Ann Moreland, and I'm sure that's gonna be good. You're gonna have a good time, ladies. So plan on that. Get signed up. Sign up sheet is also down there on the table. Then remember, a week from Tuesday, the 24th, the Grove City School of the Bible will resume 7:00 p.m. on Tuesday evening. All right. Well, let's take a moment and let's welcome any guests we have with us this morning. And we're always delighted when folks visit with us. And we have some folks visiting today. Beside Brother Charpette over here, this is missionary Josh Smith, correct? Brother Josh is here, been a veteran missionary in Argentina. And thank you for coming this morning, my friend. It's great to meet you and good to have you in the service today. And then right down here behind Quentin and Susan, this is Mimi and her son Nicodemus. And good to have you with us today. And then you have a little one in the nursery? Is that right? Yeah, I thought so. And great to have you with us today. This lady was invited by Carol Hoskins, I believe. You're the one. Is she the one you see at the laundromat? Invite you to come? There you go, see? And that's great. Good job, Carol. And thank you for coming to the service today. Anybody else here today for the first time that we could meet you? Looking around? I don't think so. All right. If you'll be kind enough to take a moment and fill out the card for us this morning, we appreciate you doing that. In a little bit, we have an offering, and just drop the card in the plate if you would, and keep the pen as our gift to you for coming. We're glad you're here this morning. Let's give them a warm welcome, shall we?
Thank you.
may remain seated as we sing that verse together. Down in the valley with my Savior I would go, where the flowers are blooming and the sweet waters flow. Everywhere he laid me I would follow, follow on, walking in his footsteps till the crown be won. Follow, follow, I would follow Jesus. Anywhere, everywhere, I would follow on. Follow, follow, I would follow Jesus. Everywhere he leads me, I would follow on. Down in the valley with my Savior I would go, where the storms are sweeping and the dark waters flow. With his hand to lead me, I will never, never fear. Danger cannot frighten me if my Lord is near. Follow, follow, I would follow Jesus. Anywhere, everywhere, I would follow on. Follow, follow, I would follow Jesus. Everywhere he leads me, I will follow on. As we sing this last, children, you can be dismissed to junior church. Children, you are dismissed to junior church on that last. Down in the valley or upon the mountain steep, close beside my Savior would my soul ever keep. He will lead me safely in the path that he has trod, up to where they gather on the hills of God. Follow, follow, I would follow Jesus. Anywhere, everywhere, I would follow on. Follow, follow, I would follow Jesus. Anywhere he leads me, I will follow on. Amen. Great singing this morning. Let's turn over to 56. Number 56, on a hill far away stood an old rugged cross. When you find that, if you would stand, we'll sing this first and second stanza, the old rugged cross. All that first together. On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross, where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Oh, that old rugged cross, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction to me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to perish to dark Calvary. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guest. We'll come back and sing that last stanza together. shall cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. To that old rugged cross I will ever be true. Let's sing that last together. When we get to the chorus, we'll have the instruments drop out. We'll sing that a cappella, all right? Let's sing that last together. To the old rugged cross I will ever be true. Its shame and reproach gladly bear. Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown.
Everybody say amen. Amen. Great singing this morning. Be seated if you will. We'll get ready to receive our offering today. Give as God has blessed and prospered you. And by the way, we have the we have more quarter folders if you want some for the Bibles for India. If you need a quarter folder, the ushers have those in the cabinet. They'll be happy to get it for you. And you can now the dollar folders. You understand those don't have to be dollar coins. They're dollar bills. You can just fold up and stick in those little slots. Okay. Somebody thought, oh, I got to go buy dollar coins. No, you don't have to buy dollar coins. In fact, I'd rather you not buy dollar coins. Okay. And so just the dollar bills folded and put in there. And let's keep those coming. Many come in today. Keep those coming in throughout the month. Everything in by February 5th. Okay. And that'll be such a blessing. Boy, the pastor there, Brother Yoder, I don't know if he sent it to you. He sent me a photo. I think there were, I'm trying to picture in my mind, one, two, three, four, at least five couples, husbands and wives. And he just sent me that picture. And I said, who are these people in the picture? He said, these were all people that visited our services today. Five new couples in the service. He's pretty excited. He said, man, that's great. And they're getting excited about what the Lord's going to do there. And we're excited to be able to get some Bibles for them. So get involved with that. If you need some more quarter folders, they have them. And they have the dollar ones as well. All right. And then the box is ready. And you can deposit them in here when you get them. All right. Thank you for participating in that. Brother Wallace, lead us in our prayer this morning.
Your word might be spread, and Father, we just pray and we desire to hear from you today, that when we walk out those doors, we can say in our heart that we've heard from the throne on high. Father, bless the offering now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Take your Bible this morning, if you would, please. Acts chapter 13. Acts chapter 13 for our scripture reading this morning. Acts chapter 13, and we're going to read the first five verses, and we read them responsibly. We begin together on verse 1, then I'll read 2, and we together on 3, and we alternate 8 until we end together on verse 5 of Acts chapter 13. As our custom is, let's stand together to read the scripture. All of us standing, please, to read God's word, and let's begin together on verse 1 of Acts chapter 13. Ready? Now there were in the church that was at Antioch certain prophets and teachers, as Barnabas, and Simeon that was called Niger, and Lucius of Cyrene, and Manaen, which had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul. As they ministered to the Lord and fasted, the Holy Ghost said, "Separate me Barnabas and Saul for the work whereunto I have called them." And when they had fasted and prayed, and laid their hands on them, they sent them away. So they, being sent forth by the Holy Ghost, departed unto Seleucia, and from thence they sailed to Cyprus. And when they were at Salamis, they preached the word of God in the synagogues of the Jews, and they had also John to their minister. And let's pray together, shall we? Father, add your blessing, please, to the reading of the scripture this morning. We thank you, Lord, for the word of God, and thank you for preserving your word for us that we hold copies of it in our hands this morning. Lord, we don't believe this is just the words of men or the words of a man. We believe it to be in truth the words of God. And so, Lord, I pray that it would be effectual and work effectually in each of us who believe this morning. And I pray, Lord, that you would continue to make our hearts ready, and that our hearts would be good soil that the word of God would fall into and bring forth fruit this morning. Bless the special to that end. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Soon this life will all be over, and our pilgrimage will end. Soon we'll take our heavenly journey, be at home again with friends. Heaven's gates are standing open, waiting for our entrance there. Soon we'll say we're going over, all the beauties there to share. Just a little while to stay here, just a little while to wait. Just a little while to labor in the path that's always straight. Just a little more of trouble in this moment's sinful state. Then we'll be heaven's portals sweeping through the pearly gates. Soon we'll see the light of morning. It will good, it will begin. Soon we'll hear the Father calling, come my children, enter in. Then we'll hear the choir of angels singing out the victory song. Our troubles will be ended, and we'll live with heaven strong. Just a little while to stay here, just a little while to wait. Just a little while to labor in the path that's always straight. Just a little more of trouble in this loving sinful state. Then we'll enter heaven's portals, sweeping through the pearly gates. Just a little while to stay here, just a little while to wait. Just a little while to labor in the path that's always straight. Just a little more of trouble in the slow and sinful state. Then we'll enter heaven's portals, sweeping through the pearly gates.
Amen. Our Father, we bow before you in prayer now. We thank you, Lord, for the wonderful music this morning. And Lord, it's helped us. It's ministered to our hearts. And I pray that it has been enjoyable for you as well as you listen to your people sing your praises and talk about the wonderful God you are and the wonderful things you do for each one of us. Now, Father, I bow before you as we open up your word this morning and we look into it for help and for instruction. And I pray, God, that you would minister to our hearts today as only you can. Thank you for the Sharpetta family and your calling upon their life. And I pray, God, that your hand would rest upon them as they continue to prepare and then leave for the field you've called them to. And Father, I pray that this message would be a help and an encouragement to them as well as others who will be listening in this morning. So, Father, meet with us, and may your will be accomplished in every heart and life. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Back in Acts chapter 13, if you would, and Brother Sharpetta had asked when he wanted to come, he asked that I would preach to them this morning. And so I'm going to do that, and the good thing is you get to listen in. All right? Isn't it always fun to eavesdrop on someone else's conversation, you know? And you'll get a little chance to do that today. And my mind went to Acts chapter 13, where this is the first missionaries being sent out by the church. And if you think about the book of Acts, the stage is set in the book of Acts, in Acts 1 and verse 8, where the Bible, where Jesus told his disciples, "You'll receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you'll be witnesses unto me." Remember what he said? Both in Jerusalem and in Judea and in Samaria, and then where? The uttermost parts of the world. And that was the program, and they started well in Jerusalem. In fact, they started extremely well in Jerusalem. The first time they had a service and preached the gospel, 3,000 people were saved and baptized. That's a pretty good first day. And your church grew from 120 to 3,120. That's pretty good. And they begin to add believers, and then the Bible says they multiplied believers. And I don't know, different historical reports will tell you that they may have had as many as 60,000 people in that church in just a few short months. It was just an unbelievable thing. The problem is, you get to Acts chapter 7 and 8, the church is growing, but they're not leaving Jerusalem. They're staying there. And so God sends persecution, helped by somebody named Saul. And in Acts 8 and verse 1, it's ironic, isn't it? Acts 1, 8 and Acts 8, 1. They scatter abroad and they begin to go everywhere preaching the word. They begin to go to Judea and Samaria preaching the gospel. And you notice they get to Judea and Samaria, and when you get to chapter 13, they're going to go to the ends of the earth, all right? And so you begin to see finally they're fulfilling what God intended them to do. But I do want you to, by the way, God's program is always to get the gospel to the entire world. God is not willing that any should perish. I do not believe that means any of the elect. Okay, I believe that means any. I believe 1 Timothy 2 verse 4, who will have all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. I think all means all. All means all, that's all means. And so God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. I don't think that Jesus died for a select few. I believe Jesus died for all, and he died for the world. And so we're to get the gospel to the world. And I believe God wants every believer to be involved in missions. I believe every believer ought to pray or give or go or do all three. But you ought to be involved in missions, or we're just plain and simple not right with God. That'd have been a good place for an amen right there. Amen. All right, thank you. If I have to do the preaching and the amen, we lengthen the service quite a bit. All right, so we want to make sure I'll do my part and you try to do your part. Now, Acts 13 shows us, I'm just going to give you four simple things this morning, and I want you to notice this with me as I give this to the Sharpettas this morning. I want you to notice the serving in the church, the servants in the church. That's what verse 1 is. They were in the church that was at Antioch, certain prophets and teachers, and it lists the people here, beginning with Barnabas, and then, of course, ending with Saul, all right? And these are the ones in the church. And by the way, that's where missions begins. Missions begins in the church. Not the UN, thank the Lord, and not the Red Cross or anything. And I'm thankful for the Red Cross and what they do. I'm not thankful for the UN, just so we go on record for that, okay? And missions is the job of the local church. And it was the church that confirmed the calling of Saul and Barnabas upon their life. The church confirmed that God had chosen these men. And that's why when you feel called of God, as Sharpettas were serving in their church there in Kentucky, usually every time you get a letter from prospective missionaries, in their packet, as they call it sometimes, is always a reference letter from their pastor. And what is he doing? He's just letting you know, I'm confirming the call of God on their life. I have observed them. I've watched them. And I agree that God is calling. God is separating them for the work. And usually they'll say, they've been faithful in this ministry, and they've been serving in this area, and they've been faithful to serve in this area. And they talk about their service in the church. And because they were serving in the church, God places his hand upon them and calls them to do a greater work for him. But notice where the church was located. Did you notice in verse 1, it was the church that was at Antioch? Whoa. What happened to the church of Jerusalem? Oh, there's been a shift, you see. Things are no longer, the center of operations for Christianity is no longer Jerusalem. It is now Antioch. And that shift took place back in Acts chapter 11. Would you look there with me just for a moment? Acts chapter 11 is where the shift takes place. In Acts 11, as folks had been out preaching the Word of God, a great response came to the people in Antioch. Notice verse number 19. Now there were scattered, they that were scattered abroad upon the persecution rose about Stephen, traveled as far as Phoenicia and Cyprus and Antioch, preaching the word to none but the Jews only. And some of them were men of Cyprus and Cyrene, which when they were come to Antioch, spake unto the Grecians, preaching the Lord Jesus. And the hand of the Lord was with them, and a great number believed and turned to the Lord. Then tidings of these things came into the ears of the church which was in Jerusalem, and they sent forth Barnabas, that he should go as far as Antioch. And when he came, he had seen the grace of God. He was glad. And he exhorted them all that with purpose of heart they would cleave unto the Lord. For he, that's Barnabas, was a good man, full of the Holy Ghost and faith, and much people was added unto the Lord. So, listen, many people have gotten saved. The people in Jerusalem hear about it. What are we going to do? None of the apostles obviously want to go. So they say, who are we going to send down there? Let's send Barnabas. That's okay, because Barnabas, by the way, his name means son of consolation, or what we would say son of encouragement. Barnabas is an encourager. No matter what, wherever you see Barnabas, he's encouraging somebody. And by the way, he was a great encouragement to the apostle Paul. He started out, if you remember in Acts 13 and verse 1, who was the first guy mentioned in that list? Barnabas. And when you begin to look, and when they set out the missionary, it's always Barnabas and Saul. But when you get later on in chapter 13, I think it's around verse 50 somewhere, things turn around. And all of a sudden it starts to be Saul and Barnabas, and then Paul and Barnabas. And you know what? Barnabas stepped back and let Paul get the limelight. That's an encourager. You know, that's not easy to do. It'd have been easy for Barnabas to say, hey man, I was in this thing for you. I'm the elder here. You know, it shouldn't be Bill, Saul, and Barnabas. It should be Barnabas and Paul. Even B comes before P. Huh? BP. Maybe it'll be a gas station. No, I mean, he didn't. He didn't think that. But you understand, he stepped back. He was an encourager. And so notice what he did. Here he is. He goes down. Now, where did Barnabas come from? He came from Jerusalem to Antioch. He sees what's going on. He encourages them. More people get saved. And so Barnabas says, you know what? I think I'm going to go get some help. Does he go back to Jerusalem for help? No. What does he do? He goes, verse 25, he departed Barnabas to Tarsus to seek Saul. And when he had found him, he brought him to Jerusalem. No, if you, your Bible says that, you got the wrong Bible. No, when he found him, where did he bring him to, church? He brought him to Antioch. He brought him back to Antioch. And so it came to pass that a whole year they assembled themselves with the church and taught much people. And notice the disciples were called Christians first in Jerusalem. No, in Antioch. That's where they were called Christians first. And then don't miss verse 27, because there's the shift. What does verse 27 tell us? In those days came prophets from where? To where? Antioch. God's shifting the center of operations for Christianity. Hey, listen. Listen. When a church ceases to keep missions at the heart of the matter and getting the gospel to the ends of the earth, God will shift away from that church. And that church will die. We have to keep after the Great Commission and getting the gospel to the ends of the earth. And then you find out the rest of that chapter, they're taking an offering up in Antioch. And who are they taking an offering up for? You know what they're taking an offering up for? The poor church back at Jerusalem. They've fallen on hard times. Listen to me, church. The worst thing a church can do when they fall on hard times is cut missionaries. I'll just tell you right now, we're in good shape financially. But if we ever fell on hard times, the first thing I'd want to do is take on missionaries. You know why? God will bless that. God will provide for you in that. It's like the person saying, listen, I can't tithe. I'm in financial trouble. How many understand that giving God his tithe is the way to get you out of financial trouble? You understand? I know that doesn't make sense, and you go to a CPA, he's going to tell you you're crazy. But that is exactly what God says you should do. You put him first, and he'll take care of those other things. So here Antioch becomes the Cape Canaveral of missions. It's the launching pad for missions. And God moves that headquarters because they had the mind to reach the world. They had the mission on their heart that they're going to get the gospel to every creature. And so God moves it. Listen, when the church loses that focus and the church turns everything inward and they only want to God bless us for and no more, the church is going to die. And the church will become cold and lifeless. I read this story this week. It was a local call-in show in Dallas, Texas, was asked, what was your, they were asking paramedics and people to call in, what's your most unusual 911 call? And this paramedic called in. He said, we got a call from a church, and he mentioned where the church was there in Dallas. And he said a frantic usher was very concerned during their worship service that an elderly man had passed out and appeared to be dead. The usher couldn't find a pulse and there was no noticeable breathing. And of course, the guy on the radio said, well, what's so unusual and demanding about that particular call? And the paramedic said, well, here's the thing. We carried four guys out before we found the one who was dead. That's a pretty dead church. Now listen, Antioch wasn't like that. It was exciting to go to church. They were exciting. And listen, when your heart is to get the gospel to the world, how exciting is it to come to church? How exciting is it when you're going to get pictures back of people receiving the first Bible they've ever had? Because you, all we did was put a dollar, set aside a few dollars or a few quarters. Huh? And we're giving them the most precious thing they've ever gotten in their whole life. Wow. How wonderful that is. So God moved it to Antioch. And listen, America, we put on our nice clothes and we leave our nice homes and we drive our nice cars and we come to a nice building and we have a nice atmosphere, and it may be too cold for some and too warm for others, but we adjust it either way. We have padded seats to sit in. We have carpeted buildings. And we may hear a nice sermon, and we may go out to eat after service, and we may take a Sunday afternoon nap. And many Christians do that today without ever a thought that there are literally billions of people in this world that are going to die and never hear of Jesus Christ. And we're perfectly content to let them die and go to hell. I get grieved when I read things by Christian people telling, why don't all the Muslim people just go back home? Do you realize that, listen, we wouldn't have the conditions that we have now if we would have gone with the gospel like we're supposed to have gone. But I believe this. I believe God is being gracious, and he's bringing people to us. Why don't we take the opportunity to give them the gospel? Listen, don't believe. Someone said, well, Islam, and you'll hear a news report, Islam is the fastest growing religion in the world. I would take exception to that statement. I think it's the fastest growing enforced religion in the world. But the fastest growing religion in the world has been and still is Christianity, because of the power of the gospel. And the power of the gospel will still save the lost. So listen, they were serving in the church. And I like the fact it says they were in the church. They weren't just at church. They're always in every church. You probably have them in your church. That they come to church and they're at church, but you rarely see them in church. Oh, they know the foyer real well, and they know the bathrooms real well, and they know other area hallways real well, but they don't know the auditorium very well. You don't be somebody that is at church and is never in church. Don't bow your head. It's not time to pray. All right? Aren't you glad you came this morning? Yes, I know. God said, separate me, Barnabas and Saul, for the work I've called them to do. The best thing you can do after salvation is be faithful to church. Be in church Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, and then get involved. Get in. Get involved in the church. You know, when the Cavaliers made their run last year to the NBA title, they would have shirts all in. I'm all in. I wonder if we could see spiritually who was all in, how many of us would have a t-shirt? Are you all in? Are you in serving God? Are you in living your life for Him? You say, well, what's to be about that? Well, we're still talking about Barnabas and Saul 2,000 years later. We're still talking about them. There was a church that used to have what they called quitting meetings. You may have ever heard of a quitting meeting. They had a meeting where they just had testimonies and people would stand up and say what they're quitting. Maybe quitting cigarettes or quitting cussing or quitting smoking or whatever the thing is that they're dealing with. But one woman stood up and she said, I'm gonna quit doing nothing. I'm gonna start doing something. That's a good thing to do. Quit doing nothing and start doing something for God. Servants. They were serving in the church when God placed His hand upon them. Now, let me notice number two, the separation of the servants. The separation of the servants, verse 2. As they ministered to the Lord and fasted, the Holy Ghost said, separate me, Barnabas and Saul, for the work whereunto I have called them. Notice they were separated by the Holy Ghost. They weren't mama or papa called, okay? They didn't even put themselves in the ministry. This is something that God calls you to do. And the Holy Spirit speaks to your heart. Yet they didn't make a career choice. Okay? They didn't choose. I know sometimes people don't grasp that. So people are going to be missionaries, whether it's the Morelands or the Paracs or Brother Yoder or Charpetas or Brother Smith. You know, somebody says, well, why did you choose Argentina? You know, and your response is, I didn't choose Argentina. You know, that's what God chose. That's what God made the decision, not me. And so, and by the way, God hasn't just called them. God's still calling people now. God's still calling people today. He may be calling you. I remember when I surrendered to serve God full time, 40 years ago this month, 40 years ago, January, it was January of 1977. Wow. But I didn't, and by the way, it was just a January winter morning, and we just went to church. I didn't have any inkling in my heart that that was going to be any different Sunday than any other Sunday. But God knew what was going to happen that day. And when I went to the altar that Sunday morning and I knelt down and said, God, I'll do whatever you want me to do. I surrender my life to you. I had no idea, but I know this. God spoke to my heart that day. It wasn't my mom. It wasn't my dad. It certainly wasn't me. It had to be God. And that's the only way you make it. The only way you make it on the mission field is you got to know God put you there. If it's any other way, you won't last. And I know that, you know, they say the average, I don't know what average is, but, you know, they say most missionaries stay just one term and come home. And I know there's hardships. There's stuff you don't know until you're in that position what it is to live a life in another country. It's a whole different environment, a whole different ball game. The only way you stay there, the only way you continue is if you know God placed me here. If I'm there for any other reason, it's just too easy to turn back. The old time missionaries, and listen, I'm not advocating all that, but they didn't have much choice. You know, once you went over to another field, if you went to Argentina, for example, you someone might try to write you a letter, but it'd be months till you get it. Well, you talk about FaceTime technology and all that. Man, they didn't have any of that. And there was no coming home, you know, for a few months on furlough and going back. It took you several months just to get home. And so they just went to stay. They would ship all their belongings over in their coffin. And that's why Judson and Carrie in India would go 18 years, 20 years, 30 years and never come home. Because it just wasn't logical to do so. But boy, I tell you what, you better know God put you there. And so the Spirit of God said, separate me. And God calls people and He equips the people He calls. You know that where God guides, He provides. Okay? Where He leads, He'll feed. Where He directs, He'll protect. And when He sends you, He'll give you the resources necessary to do the job. He'll take care of you. He separates us for a special service. And as He said, separate me, Barnabas and Saul, for the work one too. Notice verse 3. They fasted and prayed and then laid their hands on them and they sent them away. That's why at the end of the service we'll ask some men to come up and we'll just lay our hands on the Charpetas and we'll pray over them and ask God to use them and to keep His hand upon them as they go. To provide them safety and protection and give them a fruitful ministry in Puerto Rico. So why would you do that? Because that's our pattern. That's the example set forth in the Bible. And so we want to do just what that first church did with the first ministry. It's an act of consecration. It's an act that we are acknowledging God has separated these people. He's called them out for a special service for Himself. Robert Murray McShane wrote a letter to Dan Edwards after Dan Edwards' ordination as a missionary. And he said this, quote, in great measure, according to the purity and perfections of the instrument, will be the success. It is not great talents God blesses so much as great likeness to Jesus. a holy minister is an awful weapon in the hand of God. Wow. These were Spirit-filled men. John Hyde was a famous missionary. Most of you know him as Praying Hyde. But he went to India a little over 100 years ago. And he spent, before he ever went to India, he spent hours trying to learn the local language where he was going. And in 1892, he boarded a steamer in New York bound for India. On the ship, he received a telegram from a close family friend. He opened it hurriedly. And when he opened it, the only words on the telegram were this: John Hyde, are you filled with the Holy Spirit? John Hyde got angry. He crumpled it up. It says he crumpled it up and stuck it in his pocket. In his pocket, he went to bed. And then it's his story. He says, I couldn't sleep. I tossed and turned all night. I got out of bed in the early morning hours. I took out that piece of paper and I read it again. I thought the audacity of somebody to ask me that question. Am I filled with the Holy Spirit? I'm a missionary. I'm sincere. I'm dedicated. I'm leaving my home and going to another country. How dare he ask me if I'm filled with the Holy Spirit? I've got a BA degree. I've studied the language. I'm on the ship going to India. I'm pursuing the destiny God has for me. But as he began to speak those words, he said the Spirit of God was searching his heart. As the story, his own story goes, he says he fell to his knees before God. And he said, oh God, the audacity of me thinking I could pray or preach or witness or live or serve or do anything in my own strength and power. Fill me with your strength. Fill me with your power. And Hyde became one of the greatest missionaries of all time. The Spirit of God enabled him to face the challenges he faced in India. Now listen, he was driven to prayer. He spent his first several years there with no converts at all. 3 prayer, the Lord revealed to him that he was going to pour out his blessing upon his work in India. By 1908, 16 years after he arrived in India, at the annual convention that he preached at, the Lord had him announce to the whole convention that there would be one soul saved every day in the next year. And that he would pray that one soul would be saved every day. 365 people, listen, converted and baptized, publicly confessing their Savior. Most of you know it's one thing to get somebody to pray with you. It's another thing to get them to come to church, get baptized, and can publicly confess their faith in Christ. Said 365, some people said that's impossible. But Hyde prayed. When they met next year at the convention, there had been more than 400 people brought into God's kingdom in that year. So when they gathered that year, he announced to them that the Lord had led him to double that amount to 2 souls a day. 800 conversions were recorded that year. In the 1910 convention, those around Hyde marveled at his faith as they witnessed his prayer life. Give me souls, O God, or I die. Before the meeting ended, John Hyde revealed he was again doubling his goal for the coming year. 4 souls a day, nothing less. By then, of course, he was known as Praying Hyde. And again, at the end of that year, over 1,600 had received Christ as their Savior and were publicly baptized. Prayer. Prayer. separated for service, separated by the Holy Ghost. Number three, they were sent forth by the church. Serving in the church, separated for service, sent forth by the church. They sent them away, verse number three. I'm thankful for our missions program. I'm thankful for over $34,000 that go to support our missionaries. And we're if you're, by the way, if you're not on board, get on board. We need you. We need you. I don't know whether some have fallen on hard times. We're about $80 a week behind on the faith promise. We want to get that caught up. Amen? Want to do that. So if Lord puts it on your heart to do something little more than do that, if you've kind of dropped off, get back on board. Get up and get with it. Sent forth by the church. As I said earlier, the consecrated, set apart by the Holy Spirit in the Old Testament, the tools that were used in the temple were consecrated. It means they were set apart for a specific purpose for God to use in a special way. You couldn't take the bowls in the temple home and use them for cereal. Okay? Those were set apart for God. Those were special to Him. So you have to realize that God separates people for special work that He has for them to do. One of those garden shows in the garden with what's that guy's name on the radio? Ron Wilson. Yeah, that's him. How many ever hear him before on the radio? He's on there sometimes, and he was talking one day about you can use a garden sprayer to put weed killer in it. But he said, you better mark it with a big red X so you'd be sure and don't use it on the garden. Just use it on weeds to kill the weeds. What he's saying is, consecrate a garden sprayer. Set that aside for a specific use, for a special use. And that's what happens when you surrender to God and you surrender to God's call in your life. I'm going to tell you, God puts a big X on you. I should tell you also that Satan sees that big X too. And then you become a target, okay? But we'll say more about that in just a minute. But listen, allow God to use you. These people were no different than you or me. The Morelands, the Sharpettas, Brother Smith, Parax, but you know what? They're just like us. Don't look at somebody and say, well, no, they were just in the church like everybody else, serving God like everybody else. And then God said, hey, separate me. Hey, has God said to you, I want to separate you? Has God said to you, I want to consecrate you and set you aside? I've got a special work for you to do. Are you yielded to that? Are you willing to do that? Are you willing to let God use you? Paul said we ought to present our bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is our reasonable service. Be available for God to use. They did it through prayer and fasting. Don't hear much about that these days. As they fasted and prayed, God gave them direction. God gave them and the church direction about what they should do. Understand the great sermon that Jonathan Edwards preached called Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God. How many of you have heard of that title of that sermon? Many of you have. He had fasted and prayed for 3 days. I'm told very little sleep before he got up to bring that message. And I'm told he spoke that message with his manuscript so close to his face, you couldn't see any facial expressions. You could barely hear his voice as he read the words. And yet people were screaming. People were grabbing onto pillars in the tabernacle, thinking they were dropping into hell. God moved in a powerful way. Why? I believe prayer and fasting. I believe there's when we consecrate ourselves to God, God does. When we do something unusual, God will do something unusual. See, most Americans, you would ask most Americans in churches like ours, do you want revival? They'll say yes. Just make sure it's before 12 o'clock on Sunday. Even some of you right now are thinking, all right, preacher, it's 11:40. What are you doing? You're thinking. And we God's got to do it in this timetable, or we're not going to have any part of it. Notice what it said again. Verse number 3. The church laid their hands on them, and they sent them away. Now look at verse 4. So they, being sent forth by the Holy Ghost. Well, wait a minute. Who sent them away? Was it the church or was it the Holy Ghost? Yes. You're right. It was both. You're sent forth by the Holy Spirit through the church of Jesus Christ. God does His work through the local church. I know there's mission agencies who have come alongside to help, and that's okay. But there's never a mission agency that takes the place of a local church. God works through the church. God sent the first missionaries out through the church. You have one person that has separated you and called you and is sending you forth through your local church, and that's God Himself. If you remember that, it will help you. You have one person to please. That's God. John Sununu, how many remember that name? He was chief of staff under the first George Bush, Herbert Walker Bush. He was once asked by a reporter, "Your job's very difficult, isn't it?" And Sununu said, "No, it isn't." The reporter thought that he maybe didn't hear him quite right. So he said, "No, I ask you that your job's pretty difficult, isn't it?" And he said, "I heard you. And I told you, no, it isn't." He said, "I'll tell you why it isn't. I only have one constituent." In other words, he says, "I only have one man to please, and that's the president. It doesn't matter about anybody else." And you know what? If we could just focus that I got one person to please, and that's God. That's who I'm aiming to please. "No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who's chosen him to be a soldier." I'm just in it to please God. That's why we're here. Serving in the church, separated for the service, sent forth by the church. And then I want you to notice what happened when they left. They were sent forth in verse 4. They sailed to Cyprus. Verse 5, they were at Salamis. They preached the word of God in the synagogues of the Jews. They had John to their minister. And when they had gone through the Isle of Paphos, they found a certain sorcerer, a false prophet, a Jew, whose name was Bar-Jesus, which was with the deputy of the country, Sergius Paulus. Now, what about this Sergius Paulus? Well, he was a prudent man who called for Barnabas and Saul and desired to hear the word of God. How about that? So they felt called, and then they set out on this journey, and the first place they get, there's a deputy of the country, a pretty high-ranking official, and he's calling for them. And he calls for them, and what's he want? "I want to hear what you got to say. I want to hear the gospel." You know, I don't know who God will have for you in Puerto Rico, but there's somebody there who's saying, "Man, I've been waiting for somebody to come tell me. I've been waiting for somebody to tell me how to go to heaven." There's always a seeking sinner. Somebody who's searching for the truth. We, out of Bible college, had the privilege to plant a church. And I'll never forget visiting in neighborhoods and knocking on doors, and the area we were in had quite a few Mormons in the area, and knocked on one lady, and she was a Mormon but didn't want anything to do, but she says, "You know, there's a guy down here in the corner," and she pointed to his house. She said, "He probably could use a visit." I said, "I appreciate that." I walked up there and and to the fellow's house. And were you with me? Yeah, my wife and I were there. I thought she was there. And we walked up to his house, and they were in the backyard. And he came around to the side yard. Never forget it. Amos Rogers. Ed, but they called him Amos. Bib overalls, you know. And he came to the side of the yard and introduced myself, who I was, pastor of the church, my wife. And he had a cigarette in his hand. And he took the cigarette, and he threw it on the ground, and he stepped on it. And he said, "I'm sorry, that's just a dirty, rotten habit." He said, "I just wish somebody would tell me how I could be saved." Honestly. Am I right? I'm not lying. I'm not just preaching now. I'm telling the truth, all right? And got to take out my New Testament and show Amos how he could know he's on his way to heaven. And when it came time to pray, he dropped to his knees. Okay. You know, down on my knees. And we prayed right there, and he accepted Christ as Savior. Came to church, and got baptized. Came to church, never forget, came to church, sat right on the front row. Invitation time, I didn't have to come forward. He was already there. And you know, just a, hey, you know what a blessing that is? You know what a confirmation that is, to have somebody like that? It's kind of like Boaz telling his workers, leave some handfuls on purpose for Ruth. When God does that, you're really thankful. It's really a blessing. But you know, when Paul and later on, when Paul and Silas would go into Philippi, God had Lydia there, whose heart the Lord opened, that she attended the things that were said. When he called Philip out of Samaria and the revival that was happening there and goes to the desert, and Philip says, "What am I doing in the desert? Had nobody here." And he says, "Yeah, see that chariot out there? You're going to catch up to that chariot. There's a guy in there you need to talk to." And he gets up there, and the guy says, "What's the guy doing in the chariot?" Reading Isaiah. Tell me, who's this guy talking about? Isn't that amazing? And God will have people like that are waiting. They're seeking. He's not just worked on your heart to go there. He's worked on people's hearts there. They're going to be looking for you. I believe God works both sides, and they'll be ready for you. It's a wonderful thing. Oh, they had opposition. I won't go into all of that, and you expect that. But you find out that God even used the opposition for his glory. And it helped the man believe. This fellow withstood Paul, and Paul kind of rebuked him and let him have it, and blindness fell on him. And it was such a... look at verse 11. It says, Paul said, "But the hand of the Lord is upon thee. Thou shalt be blind, not seeing the sun for a season." Immediately there fell on him a mist and a darkness, and he went about seeking some to lead him by the hand. But the deputy, who's the deputy now? That's Sergius Paulus, who wanted to hear the word of God, remember? When he saw what was done, he believed. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. He got saved. He was astonished at the doctrine of the Lord. See, thought, "Oh, this guy's causing us problems. This will keep this guy from getting saved." No. God, the gospel's more powerful than that. And God's more powerful than that. It's the dynamite of God unto salvation to everyone who believes. I tell you. There's people who want to know. There really are. There's people who want to know. I mentioned Wednesday night about Brother Morrissey, who told the story about the led a girl and her boyfriend to the Lord over hamburger. It was cold, and he didn't really want to just knock on doors. It was too cold. He's driving the street just looking for people. And he saw this young couple walking down the sidewalk. He said, "I really thought when I pulled over and got out of the car, they'd probably start running away." But he said, they stayed there. And I said, "Hey, I want to give you this. And this will tell you how to know for sure when you die, you'll go to heaven." And the girl said, "That's just what I was telling you about." Said that to her boyfriend. He said, "Really?" He said, "Yeah, we were just talking about this." She had left McDonald's. And there was a homeless guy outside of McDonald's, and she gave him her McDonald's hamburger, which is probably the best thing you can do with a McDonald's hamburger. But anyway, that's another, I digress. But she gave it to the homeless guy, and she goes, "Well, maybe that'll help me get to heaven. Amen. And he said, well, can I show you what the Bible says about how you can know you're going to heaven? Yeah, we'd like to see that. And they stood there on a cold, breezy day, and he said about 30 minutes later, they both bowed their head and asked Christ to be their Savior, realizing that it's not a hamburger that gets you to heaven. It's faith in Jesus Christ that gets you to heaven. And you know, there's all kinds of things people trust in to get you to heaven. But there's nothing like knowing. There's nothing like having God's guarantee that you're going to go to heaven when you die. You know, if you ever fly very much, or if you go to the airport, you notice there's a difference between people who fly standby and people who have confirmed tickets. The people who have a confirmed seat, you know what they're doing? They're sitting down, reading a book, doing something on their electronics. You know, they're not, don't seem concerned about anything. But the people who are on standby, they're walking around. They're looking at the people that are always going up and asking a question. Any room yet? Anybody cancel yet? Anybody? Am I got a seat yet? And they're always pacing back and forth, just worried. You know, it makes all the difference in the world when you know you've got a confirmed reservation for heaven. And when you're just standing by hoping you'll get in. You don't have to stand by hoping you'll get a seat on the airplane to heaven, my friend. You can have a confirmed seat by faith in Jesus Christ, by trusting Him alone as your Savior. And I understand, listen, it's not just Puerto Rico, it's not just Argentina, it's not just India, it's not just Armenia. It's America. People need to know Jesus Christ. Let's get the gospel to them. Let's get the gospel to them. Father, take the truth this morning. Lord, I thank you for the church at Antioch. Thank you, Lord, for their heart to carry out the Great Commission. How they sent forth the first missionaries. How we didn't have time, but Lord, they come back and reported into the church again about all that God had done with them. Lord, I would pray you'd make us that kind of a church. That we would have your heart to reach the world with the gospel. But Lord, you would place your hand, continue to have your hand upon Brother Sharpetta and his wife, their children. Provide their every need. Prepare them. Use them to spread the gospel in a dark place. Lord, I pray that there's somebody there, and I believe there is, who's been praying for somebody to come. Lord, have their paths to cross. Give them the divine appointment to give them, again, just a handful on purpose to say, you're right where I want you to be, doing what I want you to do. Father, thank you for the privilege that's ours to have a small part in what you're going to do through them on the small island in Puerto Rico. Now, Father, I pray that each of us in the room would take to heart, and Lord, maybe this morning you're calling somebody. Maybe this morning somebody in this room is saying, I believe God's touching my heart. That he wants to set me apart for something greater. And Lord, I pray they'd answer that call today. Just like the Sharpettas have answered, and the Yoders have answered, and the Morelands have answered, and the Paracs have answered, and Smith, and Lord, so many. We just said yes. Whatever you want, Lord. May they come today, bow the knee, and say, yes, Lord, whatever you want. Oh, I know, they didn't plan on it. I didn't plan on it 40 years ago either. But you spoke to my heart that morning, and I pray you've spoken to hearts that way this morning as well. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. I'm going to finish praying in just a moment, and we'll have our invitation. But I wonder how many folks here this morning would say, Pastor, you know what? You talked about having that confirmed reservation for heaven. Pastor, I have a confirmed reservation. My faith is in Jesus Christ as my Savior. And I know that if I died today, I'd go to heaven. There's no doubt in my mind about it. Pastor, here's my hand as a testimony. Would you slip it up for a moment that I may see it? Pastor, I know that I'm saved. All right, you may put it down. You're here today and would say, Pastor, I don't know that for sure. I sure want to go to heaven, but I don't have the assurance that I'm going to go. Would you let me pray for you? No one's going to embarrass you or call you out, but I'll certainly pray for you. Would you slip your hand up and put it back down and say, Pastor, pray for me? I'm not sure. All right. The message today was to believers. I wonder how many believers here today would say, Preacher, the Lord has spoken to my heart. Hey, it may be about getting in, serving in the church. It may be just being involved in missions, getting on board. It may be that God is touching your heart. I don't know what area it is that the Lord has spoken to your heart about. But I wonder this morning, you've said, Preacher, the Spirit of God pricked my heart this morning. Please pray for me today. Would you slip your hand up, Christian, and say, Pastor, pray for me this morning. Thank you. Thank you. You may put it down. In a moment, I'm going to pray, and then we're going to have our invitation. If God has dealt with your heart today, now's the time for you to respond to Him. Whatever it is He's dealing with you about, I tell you this, say yes. You'll never get in trouble saying yes to God. You only get in trouble when you say no. So say yes to Him this morning. Heavenly Father, thank you for speaking to hearts today. And I pray, Lord, your will be done now in these next few moments that we spend together. Lord, hear the prayers that are made at this altar, the consecration that's given. I pray, Lord, that your will would be done in every heart and life. Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. Thou art the potter. We are the clay. Mold us and make us after thy will. While we're waiting, yielded and still. With your heads bowed, stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, our pianist will play. As she plays, Brother Bob's going to sing the invitation hymn. God has spoken to your heart today. Respond to Him.
Thine own way.
That's right.
Have thine own way. Thou art the potter. I am the clay. Mold me and make me after thy will. While I am waiting, yielded and still. Have thine own way. Me and try me, Master, today. Whiter than snow, Lord, wash me just now. As in thy presence, humbly I bow. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Wounded and weary, I pray. Power, all power, surely is thine. Touch me and heal me, Savior divine. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Hold o'er my being absolute sway. Fill with thy Spirit till all shall see Christ only always living in me.
Go ahead and be seated for a minute. if you would please. And Brother Miss Sharpetta, you got the kids back there? Good. Bring them on in and have their children come up. Then the rest of them, you just find their way where their parents are. Please take your children back. All right. Now, well, oh, I don't know if I want nursery relieved or not. We'll see. They probably want relieved. Let's have a couple chairs set here because I want them to sit in the chairs, okay? You do that, fellas? Let's turn that around for them. Brother, Miss Ann, we'll have you sit in the chairs and your kids can kind of be around you like they are now. Just two is fine, fellas, just two. Didn't have to dismantle the church or anything, you know. Just all right, that's good. There you go. What a good-looking family. Are you the gopher that we heard about? You go for this, go for that. Do get stuff for your dad. Do that a lot. Yeah, that's a good job, man. Appreciate that. That's being a good servant. Amen. All right, that's good. Oh, we have some of the men come up. If you want to come up, we'll just put our we're going to put our hands on these folks, and we're going to have prayer dedication for them. All right. And feel free to come up. Let's get close enough. You can put her hand on her shoulder. That's okay. I think she won't mind. Okay. All right. Father in heaven, we bow before you in prayer today. We thank you so much for this family, what you have done in their lives and what you're continuing to do in them, what we believe you're going to do through them as they head to Puerto Rico. Thank you, Lord, for having our paths to cross in your plan that we would know the Sharpettas and that you would put it in the heart of the people at Bible Baptist Church to say we want to partner with these people. And what you're going to do with them in that small island in Puerto Rico. Lord, I'm praying that you'll bless them abundantly, that your power and your might will rest upon them, that they'll be as yielded to you always as they are today. And Lord, that you'll use them in a great way for your glory and for your honor. I pray you'll protect them. I pray you provide for them. And I pray, Lord, they'll have a fruitful ministry for you. Lord, keep them faithful. Watch over their children. Continue to give them a heart for people and a heart for missions. May they grow up to love the Lord and desire to serve the Lord with their lives. Father, we thank you, for the opportunity we had to have them with us. And I pray, Lord, that we'll continue to be mindful of them, to pray faithfully for them, and to support them financially. And Lord, we know ultimately that you'll use them in a great way. We love you. We thank you again for this wonderful opportunity. Help us to be faithful till Jesus comes. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. Thank you. All right. Praise the Lord. All right. I'm going to have them go to the back and stand right where Brother John, where you are. They'll stand there by the door, so as you go, you can say goodbye to them. They'll be down at Heritage Baptist, our friends at Canal Winchester, Brother Fowler and his church. They'll be down there this evening, and then they'll be heading back tomorrow to Lexington. So keep them in prayer, and their letter's in the bulletin, I believe, their latest prayer letter. So that'll keep you updated on what's going on with them, and we'll keep you abreast on that, all right? Let's stand together, shall we? Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness to us and your blessings upon us. It's been good to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Father, we pray you'll give us a good afternoon. Watch over us. Prepare our hearts for what you have for us tonight when we come back for the evening service. Make us mindful now that you go with us from this place. Make us mindful of your presence and help us to please you in all we do. It's in Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Amen. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. Let's sing that together, all right? I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by His blood.
Join tears with Jesus as we travel this sod, for I'm a part of the family of God. God bless you. You are dismissed.